is a delicacy to many people in the world, and because of its high demand, most farmers have been inspired to venture into piggery so that they can also earn from the business. Today, we are at Dr. Esther's farm, who are going to discuss piggery as a fruitful business, but most importantly, how you can do piggery while minimizing costs and maximizing profits. This is the Harvest Money Show. My name is Rosemary Tukundane.
Thank you so much. My name is Esther Nakajubi, the director Kasanje Practical Farm and Demonstration. What I do on this farm, I do pig production. I do poultry production. I do dairy production. I do some bit of goats on a small scale.
Okay.
The different poultry species. I've got chicken, guinea fowls, turkeys, ducks. And in addition to that, I called it a practical and demonstration farm.
Okay.
Purposely, we train farmers. We train school pupils, students, and university interns. We train people who would wish to become managers,
okay.
And we also train interested farmers, actual farmers come here for trainings.
Esther, you have a formal job. Why did you decide to go for piggery as your main venture at your farm?
I have passion for piggery,
okay.
Personally. In addition to having passion for piggery, pigs are very prolific, meaning that they multiply very fast. And they can give you piglets twice in a year. And by the end of the year, they are pregnant the third time. So if you concentrate on piggery, the chances are very high that you're going to get, if you look at the litter size per pig per year, it can go up to 28. And if you look at the number of piglets that you have, vis-a-vis the selling or the selling price, you would get much more money in piggery as compared to any other enterprise.
Yes.
Yeah.
Doctor, many farmers wait to acquire large pieces of land in order to start farming. Is this a necessary requirement in piggery?
The farm is about 8 acres.
Okay.
But it's known for piggery only.
Okay.
Piggery has almost half an acre,
okay.
That we are using for piggery. So the rest of the area is being used for other enterprises. The size of the farm, actually, if you're going to do pig production, the size does not matter so much.
Okay.
Because pigs do not require a very big piece of land.
Yeah.
Even in a small piece of area, you've seen the piece we are using here. You can do a lot of pigs. The two styles you've seen here, we have over 258 pigs here. So, and yet there is still more room for expansion.
Okay.
Of recent, we've got some other technologies that we can use to rear pigs. For example, you can use IMO, indigenous microorganisms, the organic way of rearing pigs.
Okay.
For the people living in urban centers, not in villages like us, they can still rear pigs because if you use IMO, the pigs don't smell at all.
Okay.
Yeah. And in addition to that, even your hygiene matters a lot. You've been here, but you've not smelled anything. If I didn't tell you that these were pigs, if you didn't move around, you would not know that there are pigs here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Dr. Esther, let us talk about the type of breed that you're breeding here and why you decided to go for that type of breed.
Yeah. We are keeping a Cambra.
Okay.
And also Duroc boars. You've seen some Duroc boars.
Okay.
Yeah, we imported some Duroc boars. Those ones are purposely for semen production. We are getting semen from them. At first we thought we would import the Durocs and use them on this farm. So the purpose was to import them. I used them on this farm. However, when farmers visited, we discovered that the demand for this semen was so high. And actually, not so many people had these Duroc boars. So we decided to change the purpose, the original purpose of importing them, to correcting semen from them. And now this semen can be accessed by different farmers to terminate. When we go into breeding, If you get a kambla is supposed to go with what we call terminal boas. Mm. And in most cases, the terminal boas that are common are the duloc, pitrine, but we don't have the pitrines here. And there's also some PIC boa lines. So in that regard, when we discover that we've got a kambla, which kambla would go with a terminal boa, which is a duroc in this regard?
As heard from Esther, you can do pig farming from a very small piece of land. You only need to be organized, precise, and you know what you want. Esther, isn't it expensive for our farmers to use artificial insemination?
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. The farm gate price of a dose is 60,000.
Okay.
But then the inseminator charges you a little bit more for the journey and the service delivery.
Okay.
But the farm gate price is 60,000. And those are two parts. If a farmer is coming from very far, inseminating as a pig comes into heat becomes too expensive for them.
Okay.
Because when I come to inseminate one, and then after one day, another one comes into heat, it becomes so hard for you and very expensive.
Mm.
So in that regard, what we do? We do what we call heat synchronization. We bring them into heat together. It's programmed coming, bringing them into heat.
Yes.
Because we are targeting probably, we want these pigs to farrow at the same time. So in such cases where farmers are coming from very far, and it's very expensive for them to go and inseminate one pig and then you go back. So what we do in that regard, we do synchronization. We bring them into heat once and then we come and inseminate them at a go. Yeah, it would be cost effective in that regard.
Cambridge is one pig breed that many farmers have settled for. Dr. Esther will tell us why she decided to go for Cambridge too.
The Cambra, first of all, a Cambra is a composite breed.
Okay.
It's a cross between a large white and a Yorkshire. A Yorkshire and a Landrace. So the offspring that comes out, the others are pure breeds. So the offspring that comes out is supposed to perform better than any of its parents. So why a Cambra? A Cambra gives you a large litter size. It has got lean meat. They are robust. They can grow very fast. And they have got a very good mothering ability. So a Cambra picked what we call the reproductive traits from the mother, and which mother in this regard, mother and the father were the Yorkshire and the Landrace. So it picked the very good reproductive traits in it. Which reproductive traits is giving you a big litter size. The press where I work from, probably I'll tell you as we go on, we had Cambras which would give us 20 piglets every following. And that's quite good. So, and their mothering ability was so good. And even our mothering ability here is so good. They give us good litter with a very good mothering ability. Meaning that if it gives you like, say, 10 piglets, I'm taking an example, it's able to win 10 piglets. Or you're able to win 10 piglets. If it gives you 10 piglets and 5 die, that means that its mothering ability is 50%. It doesn't have a good mothering ability. So, you look at different breeds. A Cambra is one of the breeds which has a very good mothering ability. That's why I chose it, in addition to other good reproductive traits. And then, maybe for the case of a Cambra at that level, if you have a Cambra, it does not go with a large white. If you want to serve it, if a gilt grows, you don't use a large white or a Landrace again. You will be back a crossing, which we are not interested in. So at that level, a Cambra is an F1. It goes with a terminal boa, a boa from one of the breeds that were selected to be terminal breeds. The research was already made by the people where these breeds originated from. That this boa or this breed is very good for termination. It's not good for the reproductive traits, but it is very good for the productive traits. And now, in that regard, the duroc you've seen there, is very good for productive traits, not reproductive traits like a Cambra, like the other mothers, large white and Landrace. This one is very good for productive traits. So now it brings those productive traits. Remember, I've told you Cambra's reproductive traits. This one brings the very good productive traits when you mate it with a Cambra and stamps those good productive traits in the offspring. And good enough, those Durocs, they have got, they are prepotent, meaning that they have got a very good ability to pass on their traits to the offspring. So when you mate them with a Cambra, the offspring which comes out will have very good productive traits. Why we are targeting productive traits at that level? Because we want it to go to the table.
Do I need a side business to venture into piggery? How do I sustain my farm?
First of all, when you're starting any business, you need to come up with a business plan. This is where we are missing it. As farmers, we don't develop business plans. When you go and visit a neighbor who is doing some bits, a little bit of farming, you pick interest in what Esther is doing, and then you run home and start, but you need to develop a business plan. So when you develop a business plan, it guides you. Eh? You never go wrong. So for a side business, I wouldn't say a side business is very important in getting the initial capital. When you get your initial capital, you may not have to start as big as I am. I also started small. I just grew with time. So you might start small, start with what you have, and then grow slowly by slowly. And when you grow, I told you this pig produces twice in a year. By the end of the year, it's pregnant the third time. So when it gives you the piglets, with your business plan, you can say, I'll be selling this number of piglets. Actually, you're supposed to look for the capital to raise it up to the level of starting to produce. So you say, I'll be selling this number of piglets, and I'll retain this as replacement stock. And then you go, you move on, eh? You know?
Slowly by slowly.
When you're feeding, you manage your feeding in a way that it's cost effective.
Most farmers distance themselves from pig farming because they're always scared of pigs. They say pigs eat a lot. How do you manage this business?
Actually, I'll first start by correcting people out there. Pigs don't eat a lot. Okay. The pigs you've seen here, they eat once in a day.
Okay.
And the rest of the day we give them water. But however, you're supposed to provide water ad lib, meaning that you're not supposed to restrict them with water. And it should be clean water. There is also a mentality out there. People always tell us, you know, being a technical person as well, we discuss and, you know, they tend to tell you that pigs don't take clean water. They drink dirty water. Which dirty water? Actually, even if the water was clean, they make it dirty for the pig to drink, which is not right. So pigs don't eat a lot. They can eat once in a day. As long as the feed you're giving them has got all the nutritive values in it, you should give them a complete feed. I've always advised the farmers that you never compromise nutrition for profit. What happens is that when our farmers want to save, they compromise nutrition, they give maize bran instead of giving a complete feed. Maize bran is just a carbohydrate which gives energy. So a complete feed, you need maize bran, which is carbohydrate. You need protein, which can be either provided by mukene or soya. You need minerals. You can get calcium is sold on market, all eggshells, all shells from the lakes. You need vitamins, which is embedded within a premix. And in a premix is very cheap. Half a kilogram is 5,000, which is enough for 100 kgs when you're mixing 100 kgs. So you need, and water. Water is a very, very important component in nutrition of pigs. The amount of feed we give to this pig depends on the body condition, how it looks like, depends on age, and depends on breed. There are different breeds. There are some breeds which are very huge or which put on a lot of weight. Like a Cambra, a mature one can grow up to 400 kilograms a boa.
Okay.
They grow up to 350. We've had them here. of recent, we've just disposed of most of them. But they grow up to that age. So the way you're going to feed a breed which is so, so tiny, the amount of feed you're going to give it is not the same amount of feed you're giving to this one, because the body requirements change with weight, age, and also with weight and age and body condition. So when I talk about the body condition, if your pig, for example, if it's a male, we call males boars. If you want to rear your boar for a long time, you rear this pig in such a way that it remains fit but not fat. Okay. So the amount of feed will be determined by the body condition. If it's putting on too much weight, you reduce. If it's getting too thin, you increase a little bit of the feed.
Dr. Esther, states well how you can manage feeding on your farm. Pigs don't eat a lot, but you, the farmer, has to manage this. Dr. Esther, did you say that I have to worry about my pig gaining a lot of weight? What happens if my pig becomes fat?
Oh, it is very dangerous. Most especially for females, it leads to infertility. Okay. They won't be able to conceive and give you piglets. And that's your interest. We don't get milk from pigs. We want piglets out of them. And for the boar, it won't mount. And your interest is to keep a boar which mounts.
Talk to us about the stay hygiene and the structure setup. Dr. Esther, can I keep my pigs clean?
Pigs are the most clean animals. By the way, I'm not saying it because of the passion I have for pigs, but I'm saying it because it's the reality. They are the cleanest animals in that a pig, once you put up your structure so well, when we look at structure, the composition of a structure and how it should be constructed, a pig knows where it does dunging, where it dunks. Okay. It knows where it feeds from. It knows where it rests from. If you've been keen and you've visited pig farms, you will see where the pig dunks. Every time it wants to urinate or dung, it goes to the place where it does it. It has one specific place. But the dirty, actually, they are not the pigs which are dirty. It's the farmers who are dirty. We make the pigs dirty. They are clean, but because we don't provide the adequate space or what is required for them to remain clean. So we find them messing up themselves. In case if you over put so many piglets or pigs in a small pen, they become dirty. But it's not because they are dirty. It's because you, the farmer, you don't know what. It does very much. Actually, the former question I've just answered, the dirtiness is as a result of how you put up your structure. Okay. And how you're accommodating your pigs. It matters a lot. I always advise fellow farmers, because I'm also a farmer, when we are rearing pigs, let's use the locally available materials. They are not so cheap, but at least you can afford them. For example, if you've looked at my structures, I used tree bags. You can see them. I used the tree bags, and using the tree bags, of course they are not so cheap, but they are slightly cheaper. And if you look at this structure there, those tree bags have been there for over now 7 years.
Okay.
And I've never replaced them. And the pigs have never destroyed them. But they are still there. And I believe they are going to take me up to 10 years plus until when I think I should change them. And then when you look at the floor, I used hardcore, which is selected in a slate-like format. So to construct or to make the floor. The reason as why I used that, it's because pigs are looters, they dig. Okay. Once it digs out a stone, it's easy to replace it, okay. A hardcore stone. And if you do concrete, it digs out, you're supposed to replace the entire floor in the pen, which becomes so expensive for you. So that's why I'm using stone slates. And now I want to advise farmers, you can set up a pigsty. You don't have to do something that is out of your reach, okay. to increase the cost of production, which is going to discourage you. You do something that you can manage and you move on expanding as the number of pigs increases. You don't have to start something too big to discourage you. And if you cannot afford iron sheets for our farmers in the village down there, you can use papyrus with a chivera. It can also be a very good roofing material. And besides, pigs have got fat. They are meant to be temperate animals, not tropical animals. So if we are to rear them in tropics, it's advised that the structure, if you're to use iron sheets, they should be so raised. If you can't use iron sheets, use papyrus and chivera. They would be better because they don't absorb heat, you know. They will maintain the coolness in the structure. And if you've also been soaking, our structures are very open if you look at them. For the case of pigs, the structure should be as open as possible to allow in ventilation and exchange of air. Yeah.
How do you balance family, formal employment, and the farm?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question. Esther, I'm also employed. I'm employed, I work in NAGRIC and IBI. It's called National Animal Genetic Resources Center and Data Bank. So I get time for my office. You just have to, that's what I told you, designing a business plan before you start guides you so well. In that business plan, you will know which much time can you offer to your farm. Like I come to my farm once in a week or twice in a week. And then what I do, I empower my workers. I train them. I give them the technical skills to manage in my absence. And I want to urge the youth out there that you can be employed and do your job, and have a side business as well, or do pig production as well. You don't have to be there because you're not going to feed the pig. You may not feed the pig yourself. But once you're there, that day you go to your farm, I think you saw me. I move around, I participate in feeding to train them such that even those days that I won't be able to be at the farm, they know how to feed this particular pig, how much water should this particular pig or feed get, and what to do with this particular pig. So it's about you getting engaged. The small time that you have to for your farm, you get engaged, you get involved. Otherwise, some people, they call them slave farmers. Eh? Somebody comes to the farm, but he doesn't want even to come out of the car, you know? And so these workers tend to own the farm because they think you're a very clean farmer. You don't want to associate with farming, despite you're doing it because you had money. So they will also treat you the way they see you behave. But the moment they see you participating and getting engaged, everybody, irrespective of where you work, you can still do business aside, as long as the small time you're there, you're committed and you show ownership by participating.
Dr. Esther, is piggery a worth business?
First of all, this land at the beginning I started with a small piece. It was 2.5 acres, 0.6 acres. But now it has expanded, I told you, 8 acres. And the money is coming from pigs. When we rear, you know, as I told you, when you develop a business plan, you can have a target. You can say that every year I will be churning out or selling out 40 gilts. Gilts are the maiden pigs, which are pregnant. And when you sell them out, they can earn you big sums of money at a go. And you get like say 40 gilts, you can be able to get about 60 million. When they are pregnant. And that money can be good enough for you to do something, as well as selling piglets and the males. I've done a lot of things. I've bought more land. I've been able to construct this structure. At first wasn't there. We've not been able to go to the dairy. I've set up a dairy plant. You're going to see another structure there, a very big one. I've been able also to do so many and educate my children. My children are in very good schools. By the owner, serious note, I've got money. You can get over 15 million just when they are going back to school, you use the 15 million, you pay there. So it's a lot. I can't even mention it.
Thank you for keeping it Harvest Money Show. Thank you for keeping it Urban TV. This has been the Harvest Money Show. My name is Rosemary Tukundane. Bye-bye. Don't forget that this program has been sponsored by Bella Wine, which produces for you the best wine to trust.